Welcome to US Education Hub. So today we are going to start the biological classification with the second part, which is the part called Protista. So this is an important chapter from class 11 CBC as well as from the NEET point of view. So let's start the chapter. This is your master teacher Shlok Pripadal. So let's start with this today's session. So if you have ever downloaded a Telegram app from Play Store or iOS, then join our Telegram channel. All kinds of PDFs, notes, tests, workbooks will be uploaded in this channel itself. And the link of the Telegram channel is being provided in the description box below. So join the channel soon as possible. So let's know the kingdom Protista. So what till now we have been discussing about the different kinds of kingdoms, the five kingdom classification that was done by Whittaker. But then after each lecture we will be discussing in detail and in depth about the kingdoms. So so today is the turn of the kingdom Protista. So in the previous lecture, we have discussed about the kingdom Monera, and now we will be going to start with the kingdom Protista. So this is what Protista is basically. It is a term, Protista, which is being derived from the Greek word which is protistos, and which is meaning the very first one. Then these organisms are usually unicellular or single. Only one cell, and this and the cell of these organisms contains a nucleus which is bounded to the organelles. Now these organisms is having a nucleus which is bounded within the organelles itself, and they are unicellular. And the protista is a word which has been come from the Greek word which is the protistos, and it is the very first. Now some of them even possess structures that aid a locomotion like flagella or cilia. Now some of the protista organisms, some of the organisms which are being placed inside the kingdom called protista. Now these organisms are having structures which like they are having that aid locomotion, like structures like flagella and also cilia as well. Now scientists speculate that protists form a link between plants, animals and fungi, as these three kingdoms diverge from a common protist like ancestor billions of years ago. So scientists used to believe and used to speculate that protists have a form a link with the between the plants, animals as well as the fungi. Now as these three kingdoms are being diverged from the common protist like ancestor itself. Now these three kingdoms have been diverged from the common protist like ancestor, which is billions of years ago. Now though this protist like ancestor is a hypothetical organism, so this is basically a hypothetical organism, and we can trace some genes in modern animals and plants to these ancient organisms. So as this is a hypothetical organism, so that's why we can also trace some genes as well from which is found in the modern animals and which is very and plants, which is very much related to the these ancient organisms as well. Now therefore these organisms are traditionally considered as the first eukaryotic forms of life and predecessor to the plant, animals and fungi. So protista, before the five kingdom classification, they were being placed in the first eukaryotic forms of life, and then either in the plant group, either in the animals group or in the fungi group. So this is about the kingdom protista, and this is the images of the different organisms which is present within the protista. So this is the total concept of what is the kingdom protista. So hope you have understood the kingdom of the kingdom called protista. So let's move to the next slide and discuss about the different types of the organisms which are being present within the protista. So let's move to the next slide. This is some of the characteristics which are being for the kingdom protista. Now these characteristics, now each and every kingdom has a very much identical characteristics which are very much different from the other kingdoms, but then these are the characteristics of the kingdom protista. Now let's discuss about the characteristics. So the primary feature of all the protists is that they are eukaryotic organisms. Now the primary feature of all these protists is that they are eukaryotic in nature, and then these means that they have a membrane enclosed nucleus. Now this basically means that they have a membrane enclosed nucleus, but in the prokaryotic organisms they don't have the nucleus, they only have the nuclear envelope. But then other characteristic features of the kingdom protista are as also follows. Like these are usually aquatic organisms and present in the soil or in the areas with the moisture. Now most of the protista organisms, organisms which lie under the kingdom of protista, so they usually live in aquatic, means in water, and then some of them also live in soil as well as in the areas with moisture. Now most protist species are unicellular organisms, however there are few multicellular protists such as help some species of kelp grow so large that they exceed over 100 feet in height. Now giant kelp. Now there are most protist species are there that are unicellular organisms, however there are few multicellular protists as well. Now till we have been discussing about the protist in the unicellular form, but there are multicellular protists as well, and then such as kelp. So kelp is a kind of organism which is about 100 feet in height, so giant kelp. It is also known as a giant kelp as well. Now just like any other eukaryotes, the cells of these species have a nucleus and a membrane bound organelles. Now just like any other eukaryotes, eukaryotic organisms always have a defined nucleus, means they have a nucleus, and they also have the membrane bounded organelles which is being present within the cell. So just like other organisms, protista of the organisms which lie under the kingdom called protista, so those organisms also has such defining characteristics. So hope you have understood the first part of the characteristics of the kingdom protista. There are many other characteristics which we are going to discuss in the next slide. So hope you have understood the first slide of the characteristics of the kingdom protista. Hope you have taken the screenshot of the introduction of the kingdom protista, and now then the characteristics of the kingdom protista. These are very much important from the protista part of this chapter, the kingdom protista. So let's move to the next slide and discuss about the second part of the characteristics of the kingdom protista. So these are the second part of the characteristics of the kingdom protista. Now they may be autotrophic or heterotrophic in nature. Now some of the protein organisms which are being placed under the kingdom protista, now some of them can prepare their own food, some of them cannot prepare their own food. They need to be dependent on other organisms for their food. An autotrophic organism can create their own food and survive. Like that, I'll say now only. And a heterotrophic organism, on the other hand, has to derive the nutrition from the other organisms such as plants and animals to survive. This has also been discussed, and then symbiosis is observed in the members of this class. Now symbiosis, related symbiotic relationship is also being observed in the members of this class, and for instance, kelp, seaweed is a multicellular protist that provides otters protection from the predators amidst its thick kelp, and then in turn the otters eat sea urchins, and then urchins that tend to feed on kelp. Now for instance, the kelp which we have been discussing in the previous slide, that about kelp. So kelp is also a seaweed, and then it's a multicellular protist that provides otters. Now, which helps it from the protection from the other predators amidst to thick kelp. Now, in turn of the otters, eat sea urchins that tend to feed on kelp. Now, parasitic nature organisms are also been found in the kingdom protista. Now, they are also observed in the protista only, and then species such as the Trypanosoma protozoa can cause sleeping sickness in the humans. So this is the protozoa whose name is Trypanosoma, and it used to cause sleeping sickness in human beings or us. Now protist exhibit locomotion through cilia and flagella. So how protist used to move or how used to locomote it? So it used to locomote it by their cilia which is present over their body, or by the flagella. Now, a few organisms belonging to the kingdom protista have pseudopodia, like amoeba. Now, amoeba, because is in some organisms in kingdom Protista, they used to move by the process of pseudopodia or false feet, and then that helped them to move. Now, Protista reproduces by asexual means, but then the sexual method of reproduction is extremely rare and occurs only during times of stress. So, Protista, the basic reproduction method which is being found or which is being observed in the organisms placed in the kingdom Protista mostly are asexual means, but then there are some sexual mode of reproduction as well, but then those mode of reproduction is extremely very rare and occurs only during the times of stress. So this is the whole concept of the characteristics of the kingdom Protista. Hope you have taken the snapshot of the previous the first part of the characteristics of the kingdom Protista, and you have also taken the snapshot of the characteristics of the kingdom Protista, the second part as well, or the second slide. So we have taken the snapshots. So hope you have understood about the slides, about the characteristics of the kingdom Protista. We have discussed the different kinds of mode of nutrition. We have discussed the neuroreproduction methods, and we have also discussed how these protista, how these organisms used to locomote it, and the parasitic nature as well as the symbiotic nature. So we have understood about it. So let's move to the next slide. So these are the kingdom Protista, the organisms which have been consisting within the kingdom Protista. So the first one is the cryosophytes. The next one is dinoflagellates. The third one is eubinoids, the slime molds, the protozoans. Now within the protozoans we have four one, that is amoeboid protozoan, flagellated protozoan, ciliated protozoan, and sporozoans. So these all are the organisms which is being placed in the kingdom called Protista. So we will be discussing about each and every type in detail and in depth. So take a snapshot of it. There are some questions that has been asked from the 12 board CBC. There are all the different kinds of organisms that has been found in the kingdom Protista. So take a snapshot till now which we have discussed. It's very much important from the exam point of view. So take the snapshots. I am telling it repeatedly. So we have understood. So let's move to the next slide and discuss about in depth about the cryosophytes, about the dinoflagellates, about the eubinoids, and the other kinds of organisms found in the kingdom Protista. So this is about cryosophytes. Now cryosophytes is a basically a group of organisms which is includes a diatoms and golden algae, that is descnids, now found in the freshwater as well as in the marine environments. Now this group including diatoms and golden algae, and which is found in the freshwater as well as in the marine environments. And then in diatoms, the cell walls form two thin overlapping shells embedded with the silica. Now in diatoms, there are the cell walls are being formed with the two thin overlapping shells which are being embedded by silica. Then diatoms have left behind large amount of cell wall deposits. Now diatoms within it have left out a large amount of cell wall deposits in their habitat which gets accumulated over a huge long period of time, which is for example a billions of years, and it is referred to as a diatomaceous earth. Now this term is very important. So about the diatoms used to left over the large amount of cell wall deposits. Now these cell wall deposits, which we have been discussed, that the cell walls have been embedded by two thin overlapping shells which was being embedded by silica. Now this is being deposited over billions of years and which is being forming as diatomaceous earth. Now most of them are photosynthetic and are the chief producers in the oceans. Now most of them are basically photosynthetic or autotrophic in nature because they can prepare their own food, and then they are the chief producers in the ocean. So they as they able to produce their own food, so they are the chief producers in the ocean. And from here only we can understand that these cryosophytes mostly being found in the aquatic regions only. So this is the whole concept of cryosophytes. We have been discussing about the first type of the kingdom Protista organisms. So we have understood the cryosophytes. This is the detail. This is the image of the cryosophytes only. So hope you have understood about the kingdom Protista, the first type, which is the cryosophytes. So we have also taken a snapshot of the slide as well. This is very much important from the exam point of view as well as from the NEET point of view. So let's move to the next slide. So this is the second type of the kingdom protista, which is known as the dinoflagellates. So let's discuss about dinoflagellates. Now they are also been found mostly in marine only, and they are photosynthetic, means they are autotrophic, they can prepare their own food. Now the cell wall has steep cellulose plates on the outer surface. Now the cell walls of these dinoflagellates are having a steep cellulose plates on their outer surface, and then yellow, green, brown, blue or red pigments are present in their cell. Now colors like yellow, green, brown, blue or red pigment color are these colors which have been present within their cell itself, and most of them have two kinds of flagella. One lies longitudinally and the other transversely in a furrow between the wall plates. Now most of them having the two flagella, one lies in the longitudinally and the other transversely, which is in a furrow between the wall plates. Now red dinoflagellates undergo such rapid multiplication that they make the sea appear red. Now these red dinoflagellates undergo such rapid multiplication, such huge number of multiplication in their population, such huge reproduction they used to occur, and for which sometimes the sea appeared to be red, and that they are known as the red tides. An example from the dinoflagellates is the example called the Gonialax. So this is all about the dinoflagellates. This is the image of the organism from the dinoflagellates. So if you have understood the dinoflagellates, we have discussed where it lives, what are the types of, means how it tries to make its own food, and then we have discussed about the different pigment colors, and we have also discussed the composition of the cell wall, and we have also discussed how it tries to move from. So this is the whole concept of dinoflagellates. So hope you have understood about it and took a screenshot about it as well. So let's move to the next slide. So this is the third organism, which is known as the eugenoids, which has been present inside the kingdom protista. So let's discuss with the eugenoids as well. So majority of the eugenoids are freshwater organisms. Now in the fresh water we will be able to see majority of the eugenoids. Only some of the eugenoids would not be found in the freshwater organism as freshwater organism, but then majority of the population is to live in the freshwater only. Now they have a protein rich layer called the pellicle, which makes their body flexible. Now over their body there is a protein rich layer which is known as the pellicle, for its movement as well, for its structure or the anatomy as well. They have two flagella, a short one and a long one. So they are having the two kinds of flagella, one is shortened and one is long one, and they are photosynthetic in presence of sunlight. When deprived from the sunlight, they behave like heterotrophs. So basically they are photosynthetic in the presence of sunlight, but as the sunlight used to move away, they becomes or behaves like a heterotrophs. So this is the all about eugenoids. This is the image of the eugenoids. So hope you have understood the eugenoid as well. These are very simple concepts, and just you need to understand about the nature of the different types of the organisms present in the kingdom called protista. So don't try to remember each and everything, or don't try to memorize it. It could be causing harmful, but it will cause danger because it will be confused within you only. Because while you try to make it in the practically in your exams, it will be causing confusion within yourself, because these each and every organism is having different structures. Only each and every organism, the similarity between each and every organism is they mostly are being found in the aquatic, but living that similarity, mostly most of the organisms are very much different from each other. So till now what we have discussed, you should be able to understand, and then only you will be able to have being having a good in your exams. And hope you have been taken the notes in your hand as your handmade notes, or you have taken the snapshots as well, so that it would be very much helpful for your exam point of view, from both CBC as well as the school exams, as well as from the NEET point of view. So hope you have understood the UP NEETs as well. So let's move to the next slide. So this is the kingdom protista, known as the slime molds. So this is the fourth type of the kingdom protista organisms. So let's discuss about it as well. So slime molds are saprophytic protists. So slime molds are basically the saprophytic protists, and under suitable conditions, under proper conditions for their survival, they form an aggregation called the plasmodium, and during unfavorable conditions, the plasmodium differentiates and forms fruiting bodies bearing spores at their tips. Now, under suitable conditions, they form an aggregation, and then called as a plasmodium. And as the unfavorable conditions starts to arise, then the plasmodium differentiates itself, and then it starts to form fruiting bodies bearing spores at their tips. Now, the spores possess true walls, and they are extremely resistant and survive for many years. Now, the spores possess true walls, and they are extremely resistant and survive for many years. So this is the image of the slime molds as well, and thus the true walls they are used to processing are true wall, and they are very much extremely resistant from the outer environment, and they used to survive for many years. So this is the whole concept of the slime molds. Hope you have understood. We have discussed about the nature of its, how it takes the nutrition, where it is being found, and what it changes when it moves under the suitable conditions, and what it happens within the slime molds when it moves to its unsuitable conditions. And we have also discussed about its true cell walls about it. So we have understood the slime molds as well. Hope you have also taken the snapshot of this slide as well for your exam point of view, which will be very much easier for you to have a good marks in your exams. So if you have been able to understand these concepts very clearly, so like the video, because we get motivations from if you have liked the video, and subscribe the channel to increase the family. The more you increase the family, the more we get the inspiration. By more liking and more subscribing, we get some inspiration and tries to make such wonderful and conceptual videos for you people, to make you people understand each and every part of the chapter from based on NCERT, which will be very much helpful for you people to get success in the both in NEET as well as in the 12th CBC board. We'll be studying from two of the 12 syllabus as well. But then understand these concepts clearly, and if you have been able to understand, then hit the like button as much as you can, and hit the subscribe button and make it green color as much as you can. So we have understood the slime molds as well. So let's move to the next slide and discuss the next type of the organisms which is present in the kingdom called protista. So this is the protozoans. So this is the type of organism which is also present in the kingdom called protista. So let's discuss about it. So protozoans are unicellular organisms, and historically protozoans were called animal protists, and they are heterotrophic and showed animal like behaviors as well. So protozoans are basically unicellular organisms, and historically or earlier it was being called as the protozoans as the animal protists. Because on the basis of they were heterotrophic and they showed animal-like behaviors as well. And there are also parasitic protozoans which live in the cells of the larger organisms. Now there are also parasitic protozoans as well which live in the cells of the larger organisms. And most of the members do not have the predefined shape. Now most of the members of the protists of these protozoans not have a predefined shape, so they consistently used to change their shape. for instance, an amoeba can change its shape indefinitely, but a paramecium has definite sleeper-like shape. Now, amoeba can change its shape as it wants, but then paramecium cannot change its shape because it has a definite sleeper-like shape. And then the most well-known examples of protozoans are amoeba, paramecium, euglena. Now, unlike other members of the group, this group, euglena is a free-living protozoan, and that has chlorophyll, which means it can make its own food. Now, their proper examples of protozoans are organisms like amoeba and paramecium and then euglena. And then, unlike other members of this group, euglena is a free-living protozoan that has chlorophyll, which contains it can make its own food. So don't be getting confused with the euglena or the euglenoids. They are something different from each other, and they are very much different from each other. So hope you have understood the protozoans as well. So this is the image of the protozoans. So hope you have understood the protozoans as well. Take a snapshot and take a note of it about the protozoans. It's very much useful for your exam point of view, and repeat it continuously for your benefit only. So we have taken the snapshot or taken a hand note of it. So let's move to the next slide and discuss the different types of protozoans that are being found in the kingdom called Protista. So this is the first type of the protozoa, which is the amoeboid protozoa. So these are very simple concepts, and so that's why we have not discussed in detail and in depth like the previous ones we have been discussing, but then these are being very much mentioned in the NCERT. That's why we are giving you, as NCERT has also given you a simple part for this amoeboid and these types of protozoans are protozoans. So that's why we have also discussed in detail, but then for your conception we have been discussed in just basics. So these organisms basically lives in fresh water and sea water or moist soil. So these organisms are basically living in fresh water, sea water, as well as in moisture laden soil. And then they show amoeba-like movements and move and capture their prey with the help of pseudopodia. So basically they like movements used to move and capture the prey as mistake while production of the slides. It has been written as prey, but then it would be prey, and then with the help of the pseudopodia. And there is a mistake, that's why sorry for the mistake. Don't be overlooked the mistake, it would be prey. And then this, the amoeba is being found, when basically they move and basically they capture their food or their prey by the help of the movement called the pseudopodia, which is also known as the false feet. Now, example. The entamoeba, a parasite. Now, entamoeba is a organism which is having the process of taking up nutrition, is basically the mode of nutrition of absorbing is basically the parasite. So this is a detailed diagram of the amoeba protozoans. So this is the whole concept of amoeba protozoans. Hope you have taken the snapshot and hope you have understood about this slide as well. So let's move to the next slide. This is the type of protozoa, the second type of the protozoa, which is the flagellated protozoans. So the members of this group are either free living or parasitic and have flagella. Now the members of these particular group are basically they are either free living or parasitic or have they are having flagella itself. And the parasitic forms causes disease such as sleeping sickness, example trypanosoma. Now, the parasitic forms of these flagellated protozoans are used to cause diseases, for example, like sleeping sickness, and this is being done by the trypanosoma protozoa. So, basically, this flagellated protozoa used to be living in free living places, and they are basically the parasitic, and they also used to having the flagella itself. And in the parasitic forms causes different kinds of diseases as well. Flagellated protozoans also causes different kinds of diseases. And one of the microbes which has been present in flagellated protozoans is known as a trypanosoma. And this is the structure of the flagellated protozoans. So, hope you've understood the flagellated protozoans as well and took a screenshot or the snapshot of the flagellated protozoans. So let's move to the next slide and discuss the third type of the protozoa as well. If you have been able to understand these concepts very clearly, then hit the like button as much as you can and hit the subscribe button and make it green color as much as you can, because this provides us motivations and inspirations for new people to make such conceptual videos. We are not taking any kinds of coaching fees for preparing you for the exam purposes, but then just hit this simple things. We don't need any kind of fees, just we need to have some motivations for preparing such conceptual videos for people. So hit the like button and hit the subscribe button and hit the bell icon as well to get the latest notifications arriving from our channel. If you just look after from each and every videos which have been arrived till now from our channel, from each and every grades we have been sending or we have been uploading videos. So if you have been watching continuously about each video, need any kind of other coaching centers, just you need an incentive book, handmade notes, as well as this video where you are being playing, either in the laptop, either in a tab, either in the mobile, wherever you are playing. So just you need three things and you will be having a success in your exam purposes. So just you need to hit the like button and subscribe to the channel for helping us, to motivate us. We also need motivations as well. We're providing motivations to prepare you for and preparation for you, so you will do for the exam purposes. We will be starting up motivation sessions as well for you people, so that you get motivated for the coming exams that have been coming in the coming time, and then those motivations will be helping you to just you need to cross those hurdles so that to come towards and come nearer to your success or your goal. So this is what ciliated protozoans. So let's discuss and move to the topic, the ciliated protozoans. So let's discuss about it as we did in the previous ones. So these are aquatic, actively moving organisms because of the presence of thousands of cilia. So these are basically aquatic, actively moving organisms because of the presence of thousands of cilia. They are basically found in the aquatic environment, and then they are actively moving organisms because of the presence of cilia like projections over the surface of their body, and they have a cavity. Like they have a cavity gullet, so the cavity gullet, a god gullet, and then opens to the outside of the cell surface. So there is a cavity which is also known as a gullet, which opens at the outside of the cell surface. And example of the ciliated protozoa is Paramecium. So this is the image of the ciliated protozoa. We have discussed where it lives, where it is being actively moving, and how it is able to move because of the cilia. And we have also discussed a part which has been opened in its outside part of the cell surface, which is called the cavity or the gullet. And we have also discussed about the examples of the ciliated protozoans. So hope you have understood the ciliated protozoans as well. So let's move to the next slide. So this is the last type of the protozoa, which is known as sporozoans. So sporozoans include the diverse organisms that have an infectious spore-like stage in their life cycle. The sporozoans are including with the diverse organisms that have an infectious spore-like stage in their life cycle, and the most notorious in the sporozoans is the Plasmodium, which used to cause malaria disease in our human beings itself. So sporozoans are basically having, are including the diverse organisms, and that have an infectious spore like stage in their life cycle. In their life cycle they used to have a spore like stage, and the most notorious among this group called sporozoans, the most notorious is the Plasmodium, which used to cause malaria in human beings itself. So this is the detailed diagram of the sporozoans. So this is the whole concept of the sporozoans, and hope you have understood the part of the last part of the protista as well. So hope you have taken a snapshot of as well of the protozoans as well as the ciliated protozoans. So let's move to the next slide. So thank you for watching our video. Hope all your concerns are crystal clear from this part of the chapter as well. And if you have any doubt, mention it in the comment section below. And till now we have been saying you continuously we make these videos after, for example, we take 3 to 4 hours for man hours to prepare such conceptual videos for you people. So hit the like button as much as you can, share this video with your friends and with the students who are being just they are been wishing, they are hoping to study, but due to this lockdown situation, due to this COVID-19 situation, they are unable to study. All coaching classes are being closed, all offline classes are being closed. That's for which the online classes are the most important, most vital for each and every student in our country. So we need to make our country coaching for India. So to make the coaching for India, we need to share the video as much as we can to each and everybody in this India to be educated, to be literate and to be one of the person to be getting successful. So try to share the video as much as you can and hit the subscribe button and make it real and tap the bell icon to get the regular notifications coming from our channel. So hope you have understood this video as well. So stay tuned for the kingdom fungus and the kingdom plantae and animalia. Those lectures will be coming very soon, within 2 to 3 days. Each and every lectures will be arriving in this channel itself. So hit the like button and hit the bell icon to get the latest notifications. Until now, till then, practice the chapter. This is a very important chapter. This is a bit a lengthy chapter as well. Different kinds of concepts we need to learn about it. So learn about each and every concepts from this chapter and make your concepts the best concepts and make yourself the best one to be the successful in the exams. So stay tuned and thank you for watching the video.